Good morning. We'll go ahead and get started. Thank you all for showing up. This is the 6th grade through 12th grade English Language Arts TIC. Alrighty, I would like to welcome our first presenters, Jill Thieben and Darci Newcomb from Boone Community Schools.
Thank you. Good morning. We'll start off with some quick introductions. My name is Jill Thieben. I have been an English language arts teacher for 9 years. I started my teaching career at Linville Sully Middle School, teaching 6th and 8th grade language arts. I taught there for 3 years. And then 5 years ago, well, 6 now, I got a job back in my hometown of Boone, teaching mostly 9th grade English. 2 years ago, I started working part-time as our district's tech or our high school technology coach, and I still teach in the classroom English half-time. Currently, I teach a class that we call English 1AB, which is different from 1A or 1B. It's a class designed for kids who are kind of on the bubble of proficiency when it comes to IO assessment. So, they need a little bit of extra support. And I also teach kind of the other end of the spectrum. I teach a section of senior advanced composition. I'll let Darci introduce herself.
And I'm Darci Newcomb, and I have been teaching a long time. I started in a little tiny community called United as a half-time fifth grade teacher. Then I went to Fort Dodge for about 5 years, and I am actually a Boonie also. We both went back home, and I actually commuted to Fort Dodge for 5 years. And then I got a teaching job in the middle school. I was reading for 7th grade for several years, then I switched to language arts. And then last year, I took on the role of, I am half-time technology, half-time literacy coach at the middle school for 5th through 8th grade. So I'm not in the classroom as often, but because I have that literacy background, this was a perfect tie-in for me.
So we wanted to share some of the things that we are excited about when it comes to incorporating technology into literacy classrooms. A little bit of background about our districts. This is our second year as a one-to-one school. We use Chromebooks. We do have iPad carts available at both the middle school and the high school for teachers to check out, but typically most of what they're going to be using are the Chromebooks. And I'll let Darci talk a little bit about the student tech team, because that's kind of your thing.
Okay. We have a student tech team both at the high school and at the middle school. The high school is a little bit more advanced than the middle school ones, but basically I have a group of boys. It ended up being boys. I had one girl that during their study hall time, they basically helped me fix Chromebooks. So they know how to reconnect the screen. They know how to, we're working on trackpads, some things like that. But because you have those little everyday little glitches that they could fix easily, they do that for me. They can replace screens that are broken. So that's really nice. They also can help troubleshoot some things. Again, I have 7th graders mostly that are doing that, so we're still working on that. At the high school level, they are also, they get credit for it, and they have more of a, one of our tech, assistant tech director kind of oversees them, but the kids will come in with issues and the tech team can troubleshoot that. They go to help teachers connect their Apple TVs or whatever they're having issues with too. So it's kind of a nice little addition. I hope for the future that we can do some more projects where a teacher has something that they actually want those kids to do, so they have more of a purpose than just repair. The high school kids do run our some media sites for us too. So,
and we had one girl this year who it was kind of neat, who was trying to maybe step in a little bit into our roles, and she, as part of the tech team, worked with a middle school classroom on designing a lesson with literacy. Mm-hmm. Helping students do some digital storytelling through Scratch, so yeah. Kind of interesting. But our purpose today is to, we kind of divided our presentation into different areas when it comes to literacy. Writing, reading, so focusing on the writing process, brainstorming, the revision process, publishing, and then getting into reading, looking at tools that we like for comprehension and for fluency. So we're going to try every once in a while to give you guys a chance to pause and talk and explore a little bit with these tools or
just kind of brainstorm how they might be applicable to you in your classroom. So we'll get started kind of on the writing spectrum of this, looking at some tools that we have for the idea generating stage of the writing process, brainstorming. I use these a lot in my advanced composition class and also with my freshmen. The three that I kind of want to focus on today are ThingLink, Lucidchart, and Padlet. I'm going to start, I think that's out of order, we'll start with Lucidchart, which is a tool for creating mind maps, cluster diagrams, and certainly Lucidchart is not the only one of these out there, but I like Lucidchart because it integrates with Google Drive and with Chromebooks. That makes it really easy for them to save what they're working on. So I'll start with a couple of student examples and then just show you briefly the site. Let's see. I think it was here. My seniors have just started a big, probably month-long research paper unit, and before they can begin deciding what resources they want to gather, they have to decide on a topic. So I have them create a mind map with topic ideas in the middle and then just branching off different categories that they might come up with ideas for. New technology, historical eras, careers, medical conditions, miscellaneous topics. And it gives them an idea here when they can see it visually, branching off of that, oh, I've got a lot of ideas about this one, then they can narrow it down to that one topic that they think they're going to have the most to say about. Outside of brainstorming, we also use Lucidchart as kind of a comprehension tool, so kind of stretching the gamut there. I had my students create a mind map. This is actually kind of a more complicated mind map called a literary sociogram of a book that we had read together in class, where they have to not just describe the main characters, but they have to use this cluster tool to explain the relationships between characters. So there's very specific rules for this about how big the shape is going to be relative to the character's importance, where you put those shapes, comparing how close the relationship is between those characters, whether it's a dotted line or a straight line. I make them put a dotted line to connect those characters if they have to infer the relationship between others, while a solid line shows that there is a very specific, clear relationship between them. So again, Lucidchart is not the only way to do this, but it's a really good way to help them just visualize topic ideas and also concepts from works that we're reading. So just really briefly, lucidchart.com is the site. And again, this will save into Google if you log in with Google. And it's a pretty simple site to use. They've got a whole bunch of shapes that are showing up on the side here, and all kids have to do is drag them over. And then they can type whatever they want in here. And it makes it very easy to connect the dots. So it's a very intuitive tool. They can insert additional shapes to represent their thoughts. But I find that very, very helpful just in that initial brainstorming process. The next tool that I'm going to kind of zoom through a few of these and then give you guys a chance to talk. The next brainstorming tool that I really, really like is Padlet, and I'm sure a lot of you have used this in your classroom before. One way that I use this with my students, with my advanced composition students, is at the beginning of the year, we create a tool for what we call Free Write Friday, and I'll share that tool with you in a second. But they have to brainstorm topics, and they also have to brainstorm genres. Because oftentimes if I just tell them to write about a topic, then they're going to do kind of a journal entry. But I wanted them to expand a little bit and think about what types of writing they could be doing about those topics. So we just took 3 or 4 minutes together as a class and on a Padlet wall like this brainstormed a bunch of different topics that they could potentially write about. So here's what that looked like. They came up with, they could write an after dinner speech. They could write a wedding toast, a blog, a news story, an obituary, a song, a monologue. Just trying to expand that idea of when it's time and I give you time to write freely. Well, sometimes that's overwhelming for students. So this helps them zero in a little bit about what type of writing specifically that they're going to do. Padlet is really, really easy to use. It basically gives you a blank wall. You give the link to somebody, share the link with your students, and they all have access to it and can just double click and type, and you all have this one spot where everybody can see what everybody else's ideas. I also use this kind of as a landing zone for projects that my students are turning in. So for example, for that literary sociogram, they turned it in on a Padlet. I had them take a screenshot of their work, and then they can just click anywhere, and it will let them type an idea, but it will also let them here attach a photo or a video so that we get that collaboration and they can see what their classmates are coming up with. Not just ideas, but also sharing their work publishing. So going back to this ABC idea, the genres is linked to this ABC brainstorming project that I have my seniors do. And we use a site called ThingLink. How many of you have used ThingLink before? So it's great for maybe presenting information, but I've used this as a brainstorming tool for my students where I had them find a picture of the ABCs, the alphabet, and you can see kind of an example here. And then they created a ThingLink where they tagged each letter of the alphabet with one of those genres that we brainstormed on the Padlet, and also a topic that starts with each letter of the alphabet. I think that was kind of an old Chris strategy. We used to just give them a piece of paper with a blank box for each letter of the alphabet, and they would write a topic for A, B, C, or D. But with the addition of ThingLink, you can see their topics will just pop up like that. But what I will have them do is on Friday, I'll spin a wheel, and it will give them a random letter of the alphabet, and I say, okay, we're gonna write for 5 or 10 minutes on the letter G today. They look at what they brainstormed for G, and then they write on Google Docs, and then they can link their Google Doc to their ThingLink. So this isn't just a brainstorming tool, it's also becoming a place for publishing so that what they are writing actually shows up on the ThingLink as well. So this is Noelle. She gave me permission to show hers. Here's some of her topics. For M, mom's birthday message, a dog short story, a tweet about an apple orchard, or several if I give them enough time to write. Then they will write on Google Docs. And on Google, if you use the publish to the web feature, then they can grab that link and put it on their ThingLink and it will pop up like you saw. So on Google, I always have them start by going to File, Publish to the Web. And then this is the link that they will just copy into their ThingLink. So they don't just have the brainstorming ideas, but they have the actual piece of writing that they did as well. So combined there, we've got the Padlet to brainstorm the topics. We've got the ThingLink to brainstorm, or the Padlet to brainstorm the genres, the ThingLink to brainstorm the topics, and then combining them together. Give you guys just a couple of seconds to maybe chat at your tables, if you could think about my kind of unclear explanation there. How could you use these tools with your students potentially? Tools. So I wish I could give you more time there to chat, but I'm just wondering if anybody has any questions about those three tools or any ideas that you came up with your group members that you could adapt some of those tools for.
We have a question from Zoom.
Okay.
They're asking if the ThingLink is collaborative. Can two students work on the same one?
No, they can't, but what you can do is they can remix somebody else's ThingLink, so they can't work on the same one, but if somebody has one started, you as a teacher could maybe create a template, And then when they log into theirs, there's an option to remix it. And then all of your tags on the thing link will be there, and they can populate it with their own ideas. So it's not collaborative in the sense that Google Docs is.
I have had a teacher use the periodic table, in science class, and every kid had an element they were supposed to research, and then every kid made their own thing link and then linked that to her thing link, so they were all together that way. So at least it was a way to see everybody else's work.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions about the first three tools we shared or ideas that you had? All right, we'll keep plugging along. So the next stage that we wanted to kind of cover in the writing process was the actual drafting and the revising stage. I've got on here Google Docs, YouTube, and Screencastify. And Google Docs is maybe an obvious tool to put on here. But since we have gone one-to-one, the way that I approach this in my classroom has changed a little bit. And I think it's been very, very helpful to students. So we know that Google Docs allows students to share their work with you, and you can comment on it after they turn it in. They can collaborate with their peers on the same document. What I like about it, as far as a drafting tool, is that if I have my students share their doc with me at the beginning, then what I find myself doing during class now is commenting on their documents while they're typing instead of after the fact. It used to be the case where they would be typing and I'd wander around, kind of glance over shoulders if somebody had a question. I don't do that anymore. If my principal came in, he would see me sitting at my desk typing and maybe be a little bit concerned, but what I'm doing is I'm on all of my students' documents during one class period, trying to give them feedback as they go. So we get that just-in-time support instead of after the fact when it's too late. So here's a copy of one of my advanced comp students' documents. Blocked out his name there. And my approach to using comments here, they do have the editing mode and the suggesting mode. And in some cases, I will use suggesting mode and just say, well, maybe try switching this word to this other one. But most of the time, I try to stick with comments. You'll see over there, I've got comments that say writing felony number one, number two. There's a YouTube series called Writing Felonies that I've kind of latched onto this year. And we went over what each of this list of, I think, 10 writing felonies were. And now I will write that as a comment while they're drafting. It makes them go back and see, oh, what was that issue that I was having? And I just leave a comment. I don't fix it for them. Because oftentimes with that suggesting mode, if you fix, they'll just want to click resolve, 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 and they don't really learn much from that process. But if I just say, hey, there's an error here, it's this kind of error, you need to go back and fix that, I think it helps solidify that in their brains a little bit more. You see here, I've also left a link as a comment. And that ties into my next slide here, which is that just-in-time support with YouTube. So this is the video series that I was talking about. I just did a Google search. One of the banes of my existence as a composition teacher is the comma splice. Oh my gosh, that is such a hard skill for them to learn. I don't know why. So I was just looking for videos on comma splices, and I found this series. He's got a whole playlist full of common writing errors. But it walks them through what a comma splice is, even though I've already done that, and shows them how to fix it. So if they need that extra reminder, then I can put that link in their document, and they can watch it, and then they can make the connection. Oh, Ms. Thieben says, I have a writing felony number one error here. I don't remember how to fix that. Let me watch this video and see how to fix it. I am working on creating some of my own videos to incorporate as links here, but I don't always feel the need to reinvent the wheel. If this is out there, they've got these great tutorials on YouTube, then I'm going to use them and just insert them as comments for students while they go. When I want to give feedback, I'm sure a lot of you can kind of commiserate with me. Before I started doing what I'm going to talk about next, here's kind of what would happen. I would get all of my papers turned in, and I would block off maybe a weekend. And I would spend hours upon hours making corrections, making comments, helping them, you know, oh, this is a really insightful comment. It's really going to make their writing that much better. And then I pass their papers back on Monday, and what do? They look at the grade, crumple it up, throw it in the garbage can. They're not looking at all of the feedback that I worked so very hard to give them to improve their writing. So what I have started doing is giving them video feedback instead of written feedback or even just comments on Google. And the tool that I use to do that is Screencastify. I will say there are a lot of tools like Screencastify out there. This is not the only one, but it's the one I like, again, because it integrates so great with Google. Screencastify is a Google Chrome extension, and I think that we have a link to where you can get that extension on that slide. But basically, when I run it, it will record my voice over my screen and any mouse movements that I make. It also has an option to draw on the screen while I'm speaking. And so what I do now is when I'm grading, I will just click record and leave some verbal comments for them. And then to make sure that they watch that and actually get the feedback, I will combine that with a Google form that I make them fill out after they've watched the video. So it's simple questions, two things that, according to the video, you did really well in this piece of writing, two things that you need to work on, you need to consider for future pieces of writing. And then oftentimes I'll add a question like this, do you give me permission to use your essay for future classes? That way I've just kind of got that on record. But I feel like it has really helped get enhance the quality of feedback. Oftentimes when you're writing something, even in a comment, your tone doesn't come through and they think that you're just being super critical of them. But they can hear that you're really, that you really care about them and that you are really just trying to improve this piece of writing, not there with your red pen saying, this is terrible all of the time. So it definitely helps build that relationship. It's also a great way to differentiate for your students. I'll just play you a very brief clip of one of the videos that I gave to my student, Noelle. I won't play very much of it because I don't think that she would want me to play the whole thing. But this is the type of comment that I would leave.
Down here, you use the word mortified, and I'm not sure it fits in this context. Mortified means embarrassed, so I'm not sure if that's what you're trying to say. If it is, then you can keep that, but I feel like maybe you want a different word there. Another spot down here. Where was that? Yeah, we have this line, a heavy weight was lifted off of your shoulders. I think that is kind of, that's a saying I've heard before. It's a little bit cliche, so I wonder if there's a way to say that that is a little bit newer and more specific to just you.
So you get the idea, just trying to pick up on things and the tone of my voice, I'm trying to be very positive and encouraging of them and not saying, here, this is crap. but I think that they're internalizing those comments and it's showing up in their subsequent work. Now, I will say, this is a lot easier for me to do now that I teach halftime because I don't have nearly as many students. I've got maybe 15 students in my advanced comp class and 15 students in my freshman class right now. I cannot imagine thinking about my class load as a full-time when I had 140, 150 students making a video for every single one of them. However, you could think about how you can use this strategically. Maybe you want to try it with one section. Maybe you want to just zero in on a couple of kids per section that you think really, really need that verbal feedback versus the written feedback. So while it might not be doable for everybody, for all of their students, this could be helpful to get you to differentiate for those students who would really benefit from that.
As a parent, I have had my kids go through Boone, and one of my oldest had an advanced class where they did this. And as a parent, to sit in a conference and hear what the teacher was saying was amazing, because then I knew what they were looking at, and it wasn't just a grade. There was some good feedback right there for that. So as a parent, it's nice to see what the teachers are saying about your kids' work too. Are you done with Screencastify? Because
yeah.
I have. At the middle school, we've been using Screencastify also in a different way. In fact, I have an eighth grade boy, so you're going to get to see his work. He's not real happy about that. But last night, they're working on speeches. And so last night, he was supposed to use Screencastify without sound and practice his speech. So I have a little video clip. How do I switch to this one?
He's got it.
He's got it? All right. So great visual here. He's in his room. But so he was supposed to be practicing his speech.
They all have one thing in common, though.
Oh, he does have words.
That one thing they have in common is that people look up to them. Sometimes there's only one person that looks up to them. But other times there's multiple people that look up to them. Famous sports.
And so he was supposed to do this last night to practice. I'm assuming they're going to go back to school today and get feedback. And, like, he's like me, obviously uses his hands. But so they're practicing this to see. But that's just something that they can do to practice. And, you know, we used to stand in front of a mirror. Now you can stand and actually get feedback on your sound also. We've had some teachers use it for fluency practice, where they record, they read, they record it. Next week they read again, so they can build a portfolio of that using Screencastify. So,
Screencastify is free, but it limits you to 10 minutes of video. And honestly, I don't think that a kid would pay attention to more than 10 minutes. So that time frame works out pretty well. It also will save videos automatically to your Google Drive, and it gives you an option to upload them to YouTube automatically as well. A couple of other tools that I just want to mention, if you want to explore these kind of on your own, Grammarly is kind of a nice tool just for mechanics kind of help. It's basically a proofreading tool. Hemingway app is a cool app that if you copy and paste a chunk in there, it will talk to you. It will give you feedback about the readability, if it's too wordy, kind of the level of writing that you have produced. And another extension, it's actually a Google Doc add-on, is called SAS Writing Revisor, which I use with my seniors because I think that there's an age limit on it. But it will help you focus on different areas, and it doesn't just fix it for you. It says, hey, you might have an error with subject-verb agreement here. Check this out. So just a couple other of those briefly if you wanted to examine them on your own. We'll give you guys another couple minutes to kind of chat amongst yourself. How might these tools work for you in your classroom? Does anybody have any questions about any of those three tools or ideas for how this might work for you in your classroom?
Did you want to talk about the...
One question that was raised was, how do I share those videos with my students? At Boone, we have an LMS, a learning management system called Converge, that when they turn documents in, lets us give feedback very easily, and I can put a link to that video in. Another really simple way to get that video back to them is just put the link on their actual Google document, and then they can watch it that way. Publishing is kind of our next thing. I'm going to kind of zoom through these a little bit because we've got a lot of tools that we want to get to. But we're always trying to figure out ways that we can get students to not just share their work with me, but share it with a wider audience. So TAC, Soundtrap, and SoundCloud, and Seesaw are three that we'll talk about kind of quickly. If you are on my presentation, then you can go to this link that will take you to a student example. In advanced composition, I have them create a writing portfolio as we progress through the year, and we publish it on a website called TAC. TAC TAC is just a very simple website creating tool. It's not really fancy. Kind of does it in a stream format, but it lets you add all kinds of content. So I have each of my students build one of these, and it's running kind of slowly. But basically, I will have them write the standards that this piece addresses, put the actual piece in, and then a quick reflection. So you can see this person has their ABC thing link embedded into their portfolio. We've got all of the different pieces of this person's research paper. We've got their brainstorming. We can see their writing process, their note cards, which we use Google Slides to do. And it will let you add an actual Google document in here as well. It's kind of a shrunken version of it, but you can still, there's an example, still scroll through it and see it. I've got a video here. That was part of our rough draft conference. I made a Screencastify video, so she reflected on how she improved her writing based on that feedback. And we do that for every writing piece that we do throughout the year. I will get a link to each student's, and I will send that to parents so that they can see what their students have been working on. I'm still trying to think about ways to expand this to an even broader audience, but that is just a really slick way to have a quick writing portfolio. A second example of publishing that I've got on here is creating a recording, making a podcast. My students do a personal narrative project, and we listen to a lot of NPR examples like This American Life or The Moth Radio or Snap Judgment, and they kind of mimic that style and add music to the background, and then they'll record it. I won't go into detail, but on Chromebooks, a really nice tool that works a lot like GarageBand is Soundtrap. And I think that that link takes you to Soundtrap if you want to explore it. It links up with Google again so they can save it to their drive. And then with their permission, I will take their final piece and I will upload it to SoundCloud. And we've got a podcast. The main street that runs through Boone is called Story Street, so we call it the Story Street Podcast. And if they give me permission, then I'll put that up there. SoundCloud, for those of you who aren't familiar, is like YouTube. Users can upload their content, but it's audio instead of video. And then another great publishing option is Seesaw.
And again, you get to see Parker's work here. At the middle school, we do student-led conferences in the spring, and so over the years, we've tried to figure out ways to do this. So we started with Seesaw, and it is right now the eighth grade, well, all the teams, but the eighth grade team has them set up by homerooms. And so when you do something in math, you take a picture or whatever, and you put it in your Seesaw. And then when you go to your science class, you put it in your Seesaw. And so when I come in for student-led conferences, all of Parker's work will be in one place. So like here is an example of, it's going slow. There we go.
I have a question about your Soundtrap, your podcasting. Are they reading their composition papers, or what were you recording for their podcasts?
Right. So I do a personal narrative assignment and I grade that kind of as a writing piece, and then I have them read that personal narrative aloud and give a kind of a separate grade for the actual recording that they make.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yep.
So they get to take pictures, they can do video, they can put links in here so you can see what their different activities they do in their different classes. So it's just a nice way to have all of their work together. And our hope is that, you know, then they'll continue to add to this as they go from fifth grade all the way through eighth grade. So
we have kind of a big push in our district for family engagement. So each one of these resources is fantastic for showcasing the work that students are doing, because we know that when they go home and parents ask them what they did at work or what they did at school, they're going to say, oh, nothing. So if we can be proactive and just push this out to parents, it really helps with that family engagement piece. We kind of zoomed through that, but what ideas do you have for using these tools with your students? You can chat at your tables. Oh, another Zoom question.
They love the idea of writing a writing portfolio, but they're wondering why you chose TAC versus like Google Sites. What was the thought process?
I think that Google Sites works very well also. I think that I didn't like Google Sites when I first started the project. I know it's been updated now and it's a lot more user-friendly. When I first started doing it, I didn't like the way Google Sites functioned. It was not very intuitive for students to use, and TAC was just really very user-friendly, very easy to get stuff on there. Now I think that Google Sites is a little bit easier, and I think either of those would be great tools. Okay.
They're interested to see what your technology use policy looks like, since you have students doing a lot of self-recording and sharing video. Is that part of the...
We can get that posted on our presentation. We'll get a link to it if people are curious about that. Okay. Should we just keep trucking along? All right.
Sure.
We'll kind of shift gears into the reading component of this. Focusing first on comprehension. So one tool that I learned about last year that I really, really love is Actively Learn. Do we have anybody who's familiar with this site in here? A couple people. This is very similar if people are familiar with Curriculet, but I think that Curriculet has been purchased by another company and is not not free, not accessible anymore. So this is a site that basically lets you have reading pieces that you share with a class. If you guys go to www.activelylearn.com, you can use this class code 65F8A and join a sample class that I have to kind of see what that looks like. But basically, it's got a catalog that you can choose from. You can also upload PDFs, and then you can send those out to a class of students that you create. You can insert questions and annotate the text. And what I like about those questions is that they are aligned to Common Core standards. So you can see kind of at a glance very quickly where students are. I think that the results summary for that is a paid feature, but you can still look at individual questions and see where students are on that. I also really, really like the visualization settings and the way it lets you move through a text with students. So I was trying to leave that on the screen long enough, so if people wanted to get that code, they could, but you've got the presentation in front of you, hopefully. This is what it will look like. You can sign in with Google, which is always nice. And they've got a catalog, like I said, and you can break it down by topic. And you can, they've got some text sets, which I like, related to other bigger topics or other works of literature. They've got, for example, a 1984 text set. So if you wanted to bring in other nonfiction pieces related to a work of literature that you're studying whole class, you could do that. This is one that I chose. And so it's got the text in here. And you can see if you scroll down to the bottom that there is a question. If you have a longer chunk of text, it won't let students move on until they've answered that question. So it chunks it into manageable sections for them. And then once they have answered, then they can see how their classmates have answered. So they can compare how their responses are with their classmates. When I design this, again, I can choose what standard that question correlates with. couple other features that I really like about this. If I go up here to text settings, they can change the font. So you see they've got this dyslexic font, which could be very helpful to help differentiate for some of our students who just need that different font to help them process. And then I'm going to try this. I love this feature. I can highlight something and say, move students here. And then if you guys are open on your screen, it will say your teacher's directing you to this spot on the screen. That wastes a lot of time in class when you say, okay, everybody, look at this page, and let's find paragraph 4, line 3. Everybody point to that so I can see that we're all in the right spot. This just automatically jumps them to that section, which I really like. Again, I can add notes, and I can see if I had the paid plan, then this is what a sample report might look like. I can see which students are struggling with which reading comprehension skills. And I can pop their questions up over here. It also lets me make the student names anonymous so that I'm not putting everybody's name up on the screen. But we can look at, as a class, oh, look at what this person said. That's a really interesting response. So again, you can search their catalog. Some of the pieces in the catalog you do have to pay for, but a lot of them are free. But you can also upload PDFs of whatever you want to look at with your students. Recap, I'll let you talk a little bit about that.
Is anybody familiar with Recap? No, wow. This is like the new hot thing at the middle school. You can put in as many questions as you want. The kids, you can set the time for the response up to 2 minutes. And so you can have the kids respond to anything really that you want. Is it the sample too late? So here's an example of how a teacher has used this.
Buddy, because he is so hilarious.
So the question was about Bud, not Buddy.
He's always joking, and he thought Lefty Lewis was a vampire, and he's crazy.
And then here's another question.
Probably when he was about to find his dad, but it was actually his grandpa. So I think that's when, or when he found his grandpa, but he thought it was his dad.
And on the teacher's end, then you see everybody's all on one screen. Everybody's answer for each question all on one screen, so you can watch through those. It also gives you like a summary of the day, so it pulls different samples, and then you can watch all of those too. It does give the kids a chance to evaluate themselves. Do they get this concept? Do they not get this concept? And you can see where the kids think they're at as far as with those questions.
Darcy's example, the kids use this as a way to respond to questions about a whole class novel. What I've done this for in my freshman classes is I used to have the reading log where they would log how many minutes they read and then get mom or dad to sign off on it, and then I had to spend all of my time figuring out, was that really your signature, or you were just really good at forging mom and dad's? I don't do the reading log anymore because I have them create a recap video instead. And I will just ask them sometimes a very simple question, summarize what you read in your book this week. Sometimes it's related to a specific skill that we're looking on, or that we're working on. For example, last week I asked, give me a passage from the book that you're reading that really shows the tone of this, or what are some specific details that help describe your character, whatever it is. So it's not just this rote writing on a log, signing your name. I get to know my students a lot better and their personalities through watching these videos as well. So I really, really love Recap as a comprehension tool. And then this is a different approach to a reading log through Google.
The eighth grade class has to keep their reading log on a Google. Where'd your mouse go?
Oh, I don't know.
Where'd your mouse go? I don't know. Anyway, it's connected to the Google Sheets, and they put in their pages that they've read. Then the teacher can go in and comment. So after they conference, So this is the example of the books they've read, when they read them, how many pages they read each week, did they finish, did they meet their goal? And then Ms. Leisure will talk to them and then ask them questions and they respond back too. So this is one of the ways that they keep track digitally for that. So
I will say that it's a learning curve for students. At the beginning, they were very, very uncomfortable with recording themselves. But I do think that that is a skill that they're going to need more and more. It's a good 21st century skill to just have them practice speaking out loud and doing it on camera. When I first started, I would say, okay, if you don't want your face on it, then just cover up the camera with your book and we'll hear your voice. And I still have some kids that do that and I'm fine with that. But you kind of have to be aware going into it that there's going to be some students who are just like, I don't want to be recorded. I make it clear that the only person who sees those videos is me. And if we're talking about acceptable use, again, it's only me who gets to see them. I'm not publishing. I'm not sharing those with anybody. One other project that I wanted to share with you is a way that I brought my maps into my English classroom. Last year, I taught sophomore English, and we studied the Odyssey. So I used Google My Maps as a visual note-taking guide for them, a comprehension study guide for them, as we were traveling with Odysseus. Google My Maps, for those of you who are unfamiliar, is a way to create a map on Google. Google My Maps. So you get to add your own pinpoints into your map. So I can drop a pin anywhere. And I can write an explanation, and I can add pictures. So I had students track Odysseus's journey along the way by dropping pins. And then they could add pictures, summaries, other explanations of what was going on. So this is my teacher example. I think I have a student example here. At some point, they wrote descriptions like this of what was happening. At others, let's see, I think it was this one. I had them write, you know, haikus just to mix it up a little bit, other different ways to summarize. And then at the end of the unit, they wrote their own additional scenes, other adventures that Odysseus would have faced. And they linked their Google Doc onto that map as well so that they could just track that character's journey. There are a lot of books beyond the Odyssey where the plot is focused on a journey that the character takes. Bud Not Buddy would be one. Walk Two Moons is another one. Huckleberry Finn. A lot of great literature where it might help students to visualize that journey through a tool like Google My Maps. So we're about out of time, but briefly, how might these tools be useful to you in your classroom?
Okay, we're out of time, but we do have, we did have another section on fluency there. So if, since you have the link to the presentation, you can look at fluency, and if you have questions, feel free to ask us about those. We do use Fluency Tutor in the fifth and sixth grade every week because of the FAST data and the way that the ELI law is going. So that's one way we use fluency with everyone. And then we talked a little bit about the Screencastify. And then the kids in eighth grade do a hero unit. And so what they do is they have to write a hero, write about someone in their family that's their hero, and then they work on the prosody, they work on the actual document, and then they record it into a Wii video, and then we invite all the heroes into the school and show the videos to the heroes. So that works on our family engagement also. And
yeah. So we encourage you guys to look at all of the resources that are linked on our presentation. Again, if you have questions, you can email us. Our Twitter handles are on the first page if you want to contact us that way as well. And we'll just kind of wrap up if anybody has any final questions for us.
All righty. Thank you.